rolling.
And then sit to the back row like they taught you at Julia. Peter Piper. Piper picked a peck.
What you see?
What you see?
And what you get is what you get.
What you
see?
What you see? Era.
It's what you get.
Yeah, it's old school, right?
I said, what you see?
Yeah.
It's what you
come on, right? Pork, egg, and cheese. Chili chest on it. Ooh. That's a nice thing.
It's the best thing yet.
It's the best thing yet. Hey, yo, what's going on, everybody? Joey C in the place to be. I got a big boombox and a new CD coming at you live from the GFY Studios. With the AO show, authentic only. Here today with my man Charlie, who's another year older and deeper in debt. Coming back from New Mexico. Last year you went to Old Mexico.
Yeah.
How was New Mexico and the hot air balloons?
It was absolutely gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
Really cool.
Yeah.
It's a great state.
It's a great state. What I saw of it was really beautiful. I could totally see how it looks a little bleak or it's a little spread out.
You were in cities though, right?
Well, my cousin lives out in Placidas, which is kind of just like out in the high country, kind of looking out over it, and you can just see the mesas off in the distance. There's some towns and stuff, but it's not like dense buildings or anything.
I mean, is there a general store and shit?
Yeah. Mercado.
It's kind of like one level.
Yeah.
You don't see this, you know, like a lot of high rise. And
yeah, it's, everything's seemed pretty low, maybe like two or three stories. We went to Albuquerque, went to Santa Fe. Pretty much all of it.
There is more?
But the first morning, we went out early out to this river, and the hot air balloons do something called the dip and dash.
Yes.
And they come down low, land on the river, and then take off again, go over the tree line on the other side. And they're like hitting trees on one side to slow themselves down, so they're hitting the water. It was pretty crazy. And like my cousin, like they came solo. My cousin high-fived one of the people in the basket. So a bunch of photographers out there in the morning.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Just all taking pictures of
these. It's a shit ton of balloons too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They said something like 3,000 flights over like the whole thing, whole festival.
Hmm.
But there's just tons and tons of balloons, like hundreds of balloons.
Hmm.
And you just see them kind of come up over the horizon. And then there's it's called the Albuquerque box, which is like the wind effect because of the terrain that holds them in. That's why it's so predictable. That's why they do it there.
Oh, no shit.
So you can just see them. They go up one side. They kind of soar over, come back down the other side, and it blows them towards the river. They dip and dash, go back up and around again.
Hmm. Any good food?
Hatch chili cheeseburger on...
Delicious.
That was Saturday night at the festival. Really good. Went to a brunch spot. Or, you know, it was like a bakery. They also do lunches up called The Range. Had some chilaquiles. And
yeah, you did.
Like every time we went out to eat, they're like, oh, do you want some Hatch chili on the side? I'm like, yes.
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yeah, man. So, this is a season too, man. It's right in the pocket. That's good.
So good.
Awesome. Any fry bread or anything like that?
I had a stuffed sopapilla, chicken stuffed sopapilla. And then on the side, it came with like another just sopapilla with honey. Just kind of like a Mexican fry bread.
Yeah.
Really?
Nice. Good. Well, welcome back.
Thank you.
Cool, man. And here we are today with today's guest, Steven Zylstra. Good to see you, my man. Thanks for coming in.
My pleasure.
Yeah. I had to, like, pulling teeth trying to get you in here for a little bit. Not so much.
Well, I'm not that social, you know.
Get the fuck out of here.
No,
everybody I told that knows you that I said he was hesitant to come on and have a conversation did the same thing.
Huh?
It's like, I got so many fucking stories.
Yeah. Well, I'm old.
I mean, and you're well-spoken. You live many lives. You got all kinds of things going on. And everybody was just flabbergasted, perhaps, that you were hesitant. But, you know, here we are. So, thanks for coming in.
Experiencing all that, there was so much of it, different things in my life. That just interesting to me because I was there.
Yeah, exactly.
I was on the spot. Yeah, so...
Cool, man. I can dig it. Well, thanks for coming in. I appreciate it. I don't want to get in the habit of summarizing people. So if you can, tell the people who you are and what it is you do.
I'm Steven Zylstra. I don't do anything now.
Yeah, you do.
I used to. Oh, no, I do things. Mm-hmm. I sharpen knives.
Yeah, you do.
And I have a pretty small collection of knives. Mm-hmm. And I'm into cars. Lord knows I have like
that's one way to put it,
people. Six here. Yeah. I don't even live here full time. But they're fun.
Yeah.
They're fun stuff. And then I'm retired. Mm-hmm. I've been retired about 9 years.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
I really didn't want to. They wouldn't have me anymore. So,
I mean, you also say you're retired, but you speak with the business owner, a.k.a. your son.
Right. Oh, we speak daily? About business every day.
Several times a day sometimes.
Because there's no scenario in our type of business that I haven't been there.
There you go.
Maybe 100 times. Yeah. So when he runs up a person or a situation, mm-hmm. I've probably done it.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Been stung.
Yeah, man.
Been rewarded, you know.
I can dig it.
So that's wonderful. And it's my boy. So he took over my business, and my dad had it before me. So
that's beautiful. Legacy business.
Yeah, almost 60 years.
Nice, man. And the name of the business is?
Faroe Iron.
Faroe Iron. Nice.
We do ornamental metal fabrication.
Perhaps a dying art.
Oh, yeah. It certainly is dying.
Yeah. And we were talking about it. You said, you know, there were some big gigs, and, you know, you could bid it at a certain price, and people can just buy some stuff off of the internet, you know, for half that price and put it up, and it's cheap.
Well,
you know,
Chinese stuff. Decorative pieces we used to make and hand rivet and just peen it and just like beautifully hand done. Mm-hmm. You can buy from China at a supplier. One of our suppliers will sell it to us cheaper than we can make it.
That's ridiculous.
And then you're bidding jobs with guys that are only buying. Mm-hmm. So it's a catch 22. You know, absolutely. Do you join the club or do you? We kind of stay in the middle.
Yeah.
Make some things, and if they don't want to pay the price, they don't get it.
Exactly. I mean, I like that philosophy. It's kind of what I do.
I know how you're
pizza shop. Yeah. It's like I buy the best ingredients, and if you don't want to pay for it, then, you know, go get Domino's or whatever.
I try to tell people about your restaurant. What I've learned here is that sustainability is a word. Organic is a word.
Mm-hmm.
And anybody can use it.
Yes.
Like I know in the parameters in the law, to be a certain amount, it only needs a little bit of something to be called that.
That's true.
But yours is the real deal.
Thank you.
Because I've seen you get angry about produce in my kitchen.
In your kitchen?
Yeah.
That was even worse than the scone conversation. Fucking scones.
Oh, the scones. I know. Man. I know. I like scones. And Joey ripped me a new one, man.
I don't say I ripped you a new one. I gave you my dissertation on scones. Charlie's part British, too, so you probably fucking love scones, don't you?
Yeah.
See? Look at that.
Yeah, he wasn't quite as eloquent when he was trashing the scones.
They're fucking dry. You need something. That's why the fucking Brits have it with tea.
Yeah.
Because it's like, I'm choking to death on this dry ass scone. I got to chug a fucking vessel of fucking tea.
You put clotted cream and jam on it. Or either or. And also you can add them together. But yeah, it needs some kind of topping.
Yes, it needs something. That's right. Now you remind me. Remember how I said I used to make them and I really like them. And I made the one kind, like the original fucking scone. With black currants in it, and we served it with fucking cream and jam because we had some kind of jam. Thank you. Now I remember that because I'm not serving this fucking choking device. I'm serving this well prepared fucking classic brunch thing.
I've had dry scones, and I thought it was just because they've been in the rack too long. You know, because some of them, like I get from those lovely women up on Columbia,
Sweets by Jen or whatever it is.
Sweets,
Simply only sweets. Sweets. Simply only sweets.
Simply Sweet,
yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, their scone has got a little bit of moisture, and it's got berries that are still a little moist inside, so you don't gag without coffee.
I have four cups of coffee and a half a scone.
Yeah.
That's the right ratio right there. Good, man.
The scone will expand. You really get two scones.
Exactly, right? Yeah, man. They're inflatable in your gut
when
they hydrate. Yeah, fucking scones.
Yeah, fucking scone.
Sorry.
Yeah, it wasn't a bad. That's all right.
Yeah. I can dig it. Cool. So we've shared some time. We have many, you know, front porch conversations, backyard conversations. Your name came up in the last podcast that dropped today. What's today? 20th?
Mm-hmm.
With Lundy Ramos. We were talking about her business and what she does. And your name came up. And I was like, you know what? I was thinking about having you on the podcast. And I'm glad you finally decided to do it with us. Because you got some stories, and they're all really fucking cool. Even the ones you were telling in the car on the way over that we might get into.
Well, it's endless.
Yeah, I mean, your life, your perspective, and getting a chance to tell it here.
Well, it's all my opinion.
True.
Which isn't held too high in some circles.
Some circles. This circles is a safe space, yeah. Soon to be sponsored by Liquid Death. And yeah, we'll cut loose. Where do you want to start?
Well, let me see. Yeah. I'm from Southern California.
Right on.
I was born in Long Beach in 1947.
Right on.
And my father was a bit of a rogue. He was a merchant mariner, and then he was in the Navy in World War II. And but we had kind of a chaotic household in the late 40s.
Right on.
Because he never really landed on anything. Mm-hmm. So, but it was really entertaining. Mm-hmm. So we lived in Long Beach, and my father got his master's degree.
Oh, wow.
Going to night school. And then he didn't want to be in Long Beach anymore, so we moved to a little town called Tustin, which was at that time was a suburb with nothing but orange groves. Mm-hmm. And we had a house with an orange grove, a small grove, and we lived there. I can remember like when I was 3 and 4.
Wow.
Little, just snippets,
yeah,
of stuff. But I was like 5, and he became a teacher. And then I went to the school he was the principal of.
Nice.
That didn't work out real well.
I'll say, don't get in trouble there.
Yeah. I was a jerk.
past tense?
My parents had me on Ritalin when I was a young kid.
Way back then, they had Ritalin.
Oh, yeah. It's an old drug.
Damn. Okay.
I don't know if it were. I know it makes you feel warm. That's the only, I remember that.
Wow.
And the kind of, I guess now I know it's like the rush. Hmm. Anyway, so I was I'm a little tightly wound a little bit.
Which, okay.
In a good way.
Yeah, man.
So then we lived in that grove, and I went to all the local, the regular schools with my buddies, the same people my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
And and I went to high school in lovely Tustin, and that's when I started surfing, and I surfed my entire life.
Nice.
My whole family, both my grandson and my son are in a surf contest today in San Diego. So I'm getting reports.
Nice.
My son's a champion surfer, so I...
Wow.
He's 50. He can still do it.
Nice.
Old man.
I mean, you could probably still do it too, right?
Well, I surfed for a long time.
Yeah. I mean, do you think you can still go out there and do it? Paddling well, out might be a situation.
I can still go do it.
Yeah.
It's the snapping up on the board that might be challenging.
Take a knee first. Yeah. Beautiful.
So anyway, we were all surfers. That's what we did.
Nice.
Cars weren't, we had cars, but it was just to get to the beach. And then I got into hot rods, and my family's into drag racing. We drag raced for 15 years, and my business supported it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a pretty expensive hobby.
It can be, yeah.
But it was fun. Mm-hmm. I kept my kids away from drugs. I kept them in the garage, bent over a car, looking mm-hmm. at a motor rather than hanging out with the boys.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed to work.
Yeah, so nice.
That's been my deal with cars.
Yeah, man. Drag racing. Driving or building?
I have dragsters. I still have them.
Mm-hmm.
And a thing called Pro Gas. It's a car body on a chassis. We made the chassis, and then they put a body on it,
mm-hmm.
and all fiberglass.
Fiberglass body.
Yeah, mm-hmm. the hood, the bumpers are fiberglass, and it has an 800 horsepower Chevrolet motor in it, and then a Vega body. So it's those little. They're so fun because they're all over the place.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Anyway, so I got too old. The NHRA won't let me drive anymore.
The senior bracket.
Yeah,
man.
So that was That was the early part of my life till I was married a few times in between that time.
Right on.
Okay. I can dig it. Forgot about those guys.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. I got married the first time right out of high school to a Hungarian lady.
Mm, good luck with that.
Yeah, it didn't work that well.
Yeah, man.
My criteria was they had to look good back then. I didn't really care how their mind
that's
was.
Good. You know? That's a good criteria. Yeah. Yeah. But the mind thing that comes later.
Yeah. Yeah, when you need aid.
Exactly.
her name was Sherry, and she was nice. She passed away last year. And then number two was Gail. That's the mother of my children. And she's living in a home or something. I don't follow that program. But anyway, so mm-hmm. she was very nice, and we were still friends. I talked to her a little bit.
Beautiful.
And then number three mm-hmm. was a woman 20 years younger than me, and I had a lot of fun, did a lot of things, but then we just grew apart. And then I've met with my wife now, Audrey,
mm-hmm.
who you know,
yeah,
who who's quite lovely.
Yeah, and we're gonna try and have her on the podcast too, if she'll.
Yeah,
maybe you could talk her into it.
Yeah, yeah. When I
she's
tell
got
her
a story too, man.
It's not as bad as I thought it would be. I thought it was like Nuremberg, you know.
Nuremberg, is that New Jersey? I don't even know where it is.
In New Jersey,
right on.
That's where the Jewish people live.
Yikes. Get a good bagel.
That's where they get. That's where they get vengeance.
Yeah, man. Beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's all the time my life was going on. I forgot about. It's really funny. I did not remember the wives until the other stuff.
Sure, I remember you. Yeah. Exactly.
It is fun. Yeah. Stuff, you know, stuff is fun.
I hear you. Cool, man. Yeah. You brought up Audrey, and I'll just recount the time we met here. So you guys moved up to Vancouver 10 years ago? 10 years ago, something like that?
8 or 9 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. Right after the pizza shop pretty much opened. Right. You guys walked in. I could tell you new food and whatnot and ordered well. And then you said, hey, you know, we used to go to this place in San Francisco called Pizzetta 211. And that's the place that I ran in San Francisco for a little bit. I was like, I know that spot too. And we just kind of bonded over that. And
it's a very small, esoteric group of people that know where Pizzetta is.
Oh, yeah. I mean, thousands of people come through that.
But I know, but it's not like a big restaurant. You wait to eat if you want.
It's 24 seats if it's not raining. If they can put the outdoor seats out, then it's 24 seats.
Right.
Yeah, inside, you know. Yeah, there's the wait list there. It's like, how many people are fucking waiting? Do we even have that much food? You know? And that's kind of how I modeled the shop, too. It's like, we're going to make 100 pizzas, and when they're gone, they're gone. Right. You know, and I really took that. It was a great learning experience. But that was a super cool restaurant, and still is. You know, Jack owns it now. But yeah, it was a cool little bonding
thing. Can picture you back. We could, because you go to the restroom there, you have to go down that little aisle to the left, and you can see a head back there cooking.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
And it was you.
Yeah. Yeah. I probably made you some pizzas there back in the day. That was a cool little spot.
Yeah. A lot of great food in San Francisco.
Absolutely.
We had a house there for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't stay there all the time, but we went there.
Yeah.
We stayed at the beach above San Francisco.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. Yeah. We talked to, bonded over some other food places like Slanted Door, whatnot. Out the Door, really good stuff.
Ooh,
Hog Island Oysters.
Out the Door, so Hog Island.
Yeah, exactly.
But I'm going down there in about 3 weeks, and I'm beating it right to Hog Island.
Yeah, exactly, man. Yeah, all the oysters you can eat. Wonder how much they cost nowadays.
Oh, I think they're $2-3 a shuck.
Each, right?
I'll bet.
I mean, back in the day, it's like, you got more oysters you can put on this table, and it's like, really? There's $100, you know?
That was... It's great because I was in there. First time I went there, there was a guy. It wasn't a weekday.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a weekend. So there's a guy. I think he ended up owning Tamales Bay next door.
But right on.
So he liked me, and we were shooting the breeze. And he saw me shucking the oysters. I'd never done that. And I was stabbing myself about every third time.
You could do that.
Yeah. And he said, I can't friggin' take it anymore. And he came over and shucked all my oysters.
Nice.
So I went in that night and bought him a good bottle of wine and came back then. So I never had to shuck another oyster as long as I was at Hog Island.
Beautiful. Yeah, man. I got a shucking lesson. I mean, I knew how to shuck, but going to San Francisco, I definitely got shucking experience. The place I worked at, Moose's, on Washington Square there, the sushi, you know, one of the best cooks there, Tony Cingoni, he was 7 or 8 time shucking competition winner. And the thing there, you had to have, there was one shucker and one eater, and the eater had to keep them all down. And Tony was a machine. This dude had to eat like 120 oysters in 10 minutes and then keep them down. So we get in the sticks sometimes, and there'd be like oysters, because oysters are on pretty much every menu there. We get in the sticks, just be a rack of fucking oysters to open. Be like, yo, we need Cingoni. And he would walk slowly back to the kitchen to go get his, it was an open kitchen. He would walk slowly back with his knife, come up and just whoo, fly through fucking oysters. Like, holy shit. Just wipe it off and walk away. Wouldn't say nothing. And he's got the name Tony Cingoni for
a gunslinger.
Yeah. It was bananas, dude. Yeah, it was like that scene from fucking Sweeney Todd when he's shaving and he's like sitting there just sharpening his razor and blah blah blah. He would just coolly walk out. Super cool dude. But yeah, that was one of my oyster experiences there. And I was gonna put oysters on a special, and I was like, oh, I'll just get him pre-shucked. And he was like, you got fucking Cingoni, just have him do them. Like. You're right. It's like, just watch them fly through oysters.
Well, I'm always hesitant if they're pre-shucked. Like, you can get them in a jar.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, they don't look right.
They're different. In a place where there's a lot of oyster production, like San Francisco or probably even Seattle or, you know, West Coast where there's a lot of them, the ones that are, you know, in the little buckets, they're super good. Like, if you're going to do something, say you're going to have fried oysters on the menu, that's a good way to go. just for labor and whatnot. And they're usually really good quality too.
Oh, I like fried. I like barbecued oysters.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Cooking them. I like them raw most of all, but.
No. My favorite is a little Tabasco and a Kumamoto.
Yeah, man. Kumamoto's are good ones.
Oh, it's too. The king.
Dig it, man. It's cool. Yeah. You lived the life. We got surfing, got race cars, hot rods.
I forgot. In between that, I got drafted.
Draft?
I just hit me. I forgot that was a big one.
Drafted for what?
I got drafted in the Army.
Ooh.
In 1969.
So that was Vietnam, yeah?
At first, I went to Fort Ord, California.
Okay.
And basic training.
Mm-hmm.
And then you find out what your, they call it MOS. Mm-hmm.
What's your job?
Military Occupational School or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I got infantry.
Okay.
Nixon at the time or something, like, was trying to get points by not sending anybody to Vietnam because people were getting pretty tired of it by the late 60s.
Mm-hmm.
So they sent me to Fort Carson, Colorado. Mm-hmm. And I was there about 6 months and I got sent to Vietnam. They had what they call a levy where they come down and X amount of bodies.
Any bodies, yeah.
And all combat infantry, usually.
Hmm.
Truck drivers and such, and yeah. Remps.
Remps.
Remps. I don't.
Yeah, man.
Well,
yeah, you could elaborate if you want. It's totally fine.
Well, a remp is a REMF, a rare echelon motherfucker. Because as an infantryman, we knew these guys were eating lobster.
Exactly, yeah.
And drinking beer, and we're, you know, picking ticks and leeches off of us. Yeah, so
that's why with the gear.
They got the nickname.
Yeah, man.
So I spent my time in the jungle.
Mm. You were a specialist, though. You skipped over that part, too.
Yeah, I did long-range patrols. And
you were airborne, too, right?
No, ranger. Ranger school.
Ranger, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I never really finished the school.
Oh, no shit, because I needed bodies?
No, I wanted to go to Vietnam because I had some friends die. And
wow.
I was, like, okay with that. And it also, I did it's crawl, walk, run. I did crawl. Mm-hmm. And then my friend died in Vietnam. And I wasn't, like, a flag-waving, you know, Yankee Doodle Dandy, but I felt so bad that I was kind of getting out of it, because those guys don't go to NAM.
Okay.
Quite often they do instructional or plays on work with the South Vietnamese.
Mm-hmm.
So then they immediately sent me to Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
And also didn't have to do one more year in the Army.
Ah.
So it's 3 years minimum before to finish the whole program.
Okay.
Anyway, so I ended up in the jungle.
Yeah, man.
And with an M16. I think I showed you that picture on my phone. Yeah.
I've seen it. Yeah, it's a good little John Wayne picture.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I can dig it.
So I made it through that.
Mm-hmm.
I think I got malaria and typhus and got an actual wound. I got a friend of mine stepped on a landmine. Tough on him.
Yeah.
And I got knocked down with that. But other than that, I came out lucky, unscathed.
Hmm.
Not unlike a lot of brothers that I had.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. War is hell.
Yeah. Yeah, war is hell. I highly recommend we don't do any more.
Hmm.
The one we're in now is so crazy.
Which one?
The one we're putting billions in.
Which one?
Well, I would say in Ukraine, I don't care about the politics, mm-hmm. but I can assure you the guy on the ground,
mm-hmm.
not the guy pulling the trigger or the guy that it's advising or the guy that drove the supplies up to him, the guys out there mm-hmm. whose ass is actually getting shot at,
yeah.
They're not as flag waving as you would think they would. You know, they just soon be home.
Yeah.
And maybe not care if Russia took a few miles, you know, or right. I don't know. That's not my expertise, but it's just, they don't want to die. That's all everybody wanted to do in Vietnam was make it.
Yeah.
So, and I think these guys are probably just like I was.
Mm-hmm.
What am I doing here?
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's my view on all wars.
Yeah. From a warrior, I love hearing that perspective, or any perspective. I've said it once before, you know, the ones that pray for peace are the warriors. You've seen the fucking horrors of war. It's like, can we just have fucking peace?
It is insane.
Hmm.
Not the war itself, the carnage, and the things that human beings have to look at and see that sear themselves into your brain. And unless you're really bulletproof, you will remember them every day for the rest of your life.
Hmm.
So anyway, I don't think these guys, whether Iranians or Israelis or, it's just my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, totally valid.
Both sides lose in a war.
Agreed.
The Buddhists figured that out like 2,500 years ago.
Exactly. It's in many, many, many books.
Okay.
Yeah, I could dig it. Yeah, there are no winners in war. Unless you get to write the history book from your perspective. We won the war. We did it for this reason. It was good.
And we're good at it. Yeah. We're good at it. Mm-hmm. So then I got out of the army and went back home and didn't have a place to stay. My wife was staying at my dad's house. Mm-hmm. My dad, I said, was a rogue. He sold a lot of my shit when I was in Vietnam. Well, he said, you know, I got to eat, man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Your wife's here. So so then he could do anything. Mm. And he had a neighbor that wanted a grill over a window, but with scrolly things in it. So my dad made it in his garage. Back in those days, you could do stuff out of your garage. Mm-hmm. He gave us my dad said, why did this guy give me $200 to make that or something? We were like, holy shit. Really? So we made up some flyers and I remember I had a clip-on tie, regular tie, but it clipped on.
Nice.
Because I just couldn't wear a tie. And I went door to door in these new areas and sold wrought iron, and that's how we started.
Wow.
Yeah, this is
door-to-door business.
I went door-to-door and handed out flyers.
Wow. And it's still going today.
It's been there almost 60 years.
That's beautiful.
A little different ball game now.
I was going to say, having been a part of a business for 60 years, you know, I've talked about it here, you know, pizza shop's been open 60 years. How have you seen business change over 60 years?
Well, it all depends on how it's changed, about how much money you're making. I mean, to me, when we were grubbing in the beginning and happy to get anything, I was much more humble. And just because we didn't have anything, you know, we could barely make the rent.
Mm-hmm.
And then as things started selling and as the years went by, we did more volume. We got a building, we rented a building, and then we bought a building, or I did, and started doing bigger jobs, you know, take jobs you probably shouldn't, maybe like you getting a 200 pizza day order, you know, you hate to turn it down.
Exactly.
So we started taking those and the business grew and it had some hard times. There was a recession in the 80s. I don't know if people remember that, but that was a pretty good one.
Yeah. Who was president then? Reagan?
Could be. I think early 80s.
Yeah, I think that was Reagan.
Early 80s, right. Well, the stock market crashed.
In the 80s too? Yeah.
In the late 80s, didn't it? 89, 87 or something. I remember that was the Robin, the girl I was married to at the time, her dad was in the stock business and it crashed. Mm. I mean, he lost millions. And then business, you know, got slow. But then, you know, we're thrifty dudes, you know, like we don't waste money.
Yeah, exactly.
So we made it through that. And then business got really good when I had, through my 30s and my 40s, it was just rock and roll. Because we could take any job and started making more money, got more sophisticated with our accounting and tax planning and material buying. And I found there was more money to be made me outselling all the time than doing anything in the shop.
Absolutely, yeah.
Although I missed the anvil and the and the forge, but yeah, it's tough if you're doing, you know, if you're doing all the work and you break your arm, what do we do now? So anyway, so it evolved into that. Mm-hmm. And now all my son does is sell and manage.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's a saying in kitchens, the higher you get up the ladder, the less you use your knife. It's kind of the same thing.
Exactly.
Blessing and a curse type thing. When I was, you know, able to have staff on that could do all the work and you could pull yourself out of the day to day and look at the broad scope of the business, work on the business and not instead of working in the business, that's where business can have an opportunity to grow because you could tweak it from the outside instead of being in there every day.
Plus you get a wider view.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's the big thing. Yeah. I was just so worried about paying the bills that I lost track of how much do I really need to make?
Exactly.
And now my son's learned that, like he was stressing over money in that last recession we had, the phone just quit ringing.
Mm.
I mean, we thought there was something wrong with the phone line. Seriously.
Wow.
You know, what's going on? And, so now he's more aware. He'll know ahead of time. We know when things, you know, when it gets, when we don't, we only do X amount this month, and that's a signal, you know, because in this June for the last 40 years, we've always done this. So it's interesting, you know.
Yeah.
Good for him.
Mikey Bilmo brought up something when he was in there last time talking about, you know, having slow months and blah, blah, blah. And he's been open almost 24 years now. His anniversary is coming up. And so he's been through 6 election cycles. And he came in and he was like, how's business? So I was like, oh, a little weird, different, you know? And he was like, yeah, election season. I was like, oh, fuck, I didn't even think about that. He's been through it like that.
What does he do?
He makes sandwiches. Charlie works for him out there in the same plaza as New Seasons in East Vancouver, Philly Bilmo's.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, yeah, okay.
24 years. So he was like, oh, election season. Yeah. And you've been through many, many of those, you know. Yeah, that could be a real game changer as far as business. People are focused on screens and debates and things, and right, not so much about like, hey, what's going to happen? I'm not going to spend money on food or ironwork or other stuff until we see what the fuck's going to happen.
No, I have neighbors that were talking about buying something, mm-hmm, and he goes, oh, no, we're going to wait till after the election. That's why I don't go. Yeah. It might be worse for you if you're buying property.
Exactly, yeah.
Plus, you just, you know, to me, yeah, I don't know. I really don't let that stuff steer me.
I try not to, yeah.
No, I mean,
if you see it in the numbers of your business, though, address it, don't address it, be aware of it. You know, it's good information. He just put it in a different perspective for me. Because when we first opened, 8 years, there was an election 2 or 3 months after we opened. And I remember that those couple months being real fucking sketchy. Because we had just opened, I'm like, fuck, you know, we were selling out every day and now we're not. And then coming now, it's like, hey, the numbers are not usually what they are for this month. And he just hit me with that, oh, it's election. I was like, I like that. Whether it is or isn't, it just gave me a breath. You're like, interesting.
Well, the whole finance with the business, I just knew I was making money. Because at the end of the month, I had a bunch left over.
Yeah, that's a good
thing. You know, so I went, oh, shit, look at that.
Money in the bank.
God, good. I'm going to buy a new truck, man. Nice. But I had this... I was going to collect money from a guy that owed me, and he used a business manager. Mm-hmm. And I went to her house. She was an older, down easter,
okay,
Connecticut Yankee, she called herself. And she, mm-hmm, I came to the door, and she looked me up, that old head to toe thing, you know?
Oh, like, really? She sized you up.
Uh-huh. And then I said, I'm here to get the check from so-and-so. Mm-hmm. And then we chatted, and I said, well, you know, she said, I could help you. And he said, I like bad boys that know how to make money.
Ooh.
Uh-huh. Because I've spent money like a drunken sailor. So she changed my life. She took my checking account away and gave me like $500 a week back in those days to buy my goodies or whatever. Fun money, I did.
Yeah, exactly.
And then and she paid all the bills.
Mm.
And it really taught me how money works in a business.
That's awesome.
Yeah. In fact, at the end, she goes, yeah, you don't need to look at your accounts or anything. This is before the computer. She goes, look in your checkbook. What's in there? That's how you know how you're doing. Ah. So that was kind of the way we still do it today. I'll ask my son, how much you got in the bank? Da, da, da. I said, whoa, okay. I know how many payrolls that is. Yeah. You know.
That's a real business owner thing. You know, you look at the amount and that question specifically, how many payrolls is that?
Right.
That is a real telling sign.
Payroll's a monster.
Yeah. Yeah. How many guys do you employ at Faroe?
Well, we used to have like 18. And I think he has 6 or 7 now.
Still, that's a lot, man. That's a
big payroll. I was churning a lot of money,
mm-hmm,
but you don't, the bigger you get, there's a declining return.
Yep.
Diminishing return, mm-hmm, I think is the right term. Yep. And you don't get as much for your effort, but you're turning bigger bucks.
Mm-hmm.
But then when a big job comes along, you can do it because you have the wherewithal.
Exactly, yeah.
But when it gets slow, you have all this shit you own. The forklift's not running, the truck's sitting out there.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, so you don't, probably same in your business.
It can be. Dealing with perishable product is a...
That's a little different.
It's an interesting thing. It's like, do I order 10 pounds of arugula or 6? Because, you know, if it starts to go funky, how am I going to use it up?
That's the advantage of iron. That's true.
Yeah. Yeah. Talking with, you know, Sherry Ann and Alex, you know, their products are a certain way and they're not going to go bad. You could buy it at XYZ price and put it in there. And
the food, I guess your food is scarier.
It can be. Perishable stuff is, right, can be questionable to work with.
Well, especially the price. Well, steel can do this too. The price could double in a week.
Yeah.
And you have jobs you bid 60 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
So then we had that. And I realized you have to put a clause in the contract to cover your ass with the material rise.
Absolutely.
If they wait too long to do the job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's brutal.
Yeah, working in the steel industry, you know, before cooking, that's where I learned about FIFO and LIFO, first in, first out, last right. in, first out. They would buy certain steels at a certain price. They would get a job, and they would allocate a specific coil for that. I'm like, this one's on top, and it's the same fucking thing. They're like, no, we bought this one for this price. Right. So it wasn't always the first one in, first one out. You know, specific ones at certain prices.
That's they're covering their backside.
Exactly. And that's, you know, purchasers and buyers and doing the big deals. And like, hey, we got this deal at this price. We could charge as much for it.
I would do that. If I sold a job, my son didn't quite understand it. Mm-hmm. It required $10,000 worth of steel, mm-hmm. The tubing mostly we use. Mm-hmm. I would get it, have it delivered. We couldn't even do the job for a month, but I have it delivered and banned it.
Yeah.
So that I know that the deposit they gave me mm-hmm. is not gone. I still got something to show for it.
Exactly. Yeah. 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 That planning part of it, a lot of people don't even understand that, even in a restaurant. But that's what I did at the steel facility for, you know, many moons before I was, you know, running the joint. I was a production scheduler. So I had the ins and outs on that. And then talking to purchasers, they were like, use this one. Then I would just try and get all the information I can, which is, you know, I was 20 years old and managing a...
Oh, but you're like a sponge at 20.
Oh, yeah. It was a lot. It was cool to really get all that information and learn that stuff. And a lot of it is even applicable in running a restaurant, too. You know, having a certain amount of product on hand and inventory and what you pay for it and knowing the ins and outs so you can make money doing it.
Hopefully. Oh, yeah. No, I have friends in the restaurant business that mm-hmm. did really, really well.
Yeah.
They had like 300 stores at the end, but.
Fuck.
Yeah.
What was it, like fucking McDonald's or Hardee's or
something? No, they sold out to, did steakhouses and they had that riverboat down. He's a good friend of mine. Hi, Steve, if you're listening to this.
Steve.
He's right my on. Buddy.
Right on.
Lifelong friend.
Nice.
We don't see each other much because he's in SoCal.
But we'll hear you on the podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah. 300 restaurants. That seems like a lot of fucking work, man.
Well, there's people with a lot of thousands.
Yeah, true.
But no, they were nice restaurants. Mm-hmm. They weren't, they had little ones, smaller ones that were, they had pretty slick.
Nice.
But they were very nice people. They did it right. They sold out when it was in the day before. And then I think it sold to a steamship line.
Oh, really? Huh.
Grace. Like
a hospitality.
Anyway, I don't know anything about restaurant, but I just like to eat.
Yeah. You eat well, too. You guys buy great ingredients. Your house has got oils and vinegars and cool products everywhere. Well, fancy knives.
Oils and vinegars might have come through this guy I know.
I mean, just because you said you like them and whatnot, but, you know, fancy knives to cut up everything.
Oh, we do have fancy knives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
In fact, we sharpen them in my garage.
Yeah, man.
As you know.
Exactly, yeah. It's a cool little respite, the little man cave situation.
It's fun.
Yeah.
Sharpening knives is more zen than making things out of iron with an anvil and a hammer.
Oh, wow.
Well, because it's quiet and it's, you know, when that forge is roaring in there, you don't hear anything.
Hmm.
You hear this. But there's something to be cool about that, too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Different aspects.
Man of fire.
Beautiful, man.
So Faroe is still there after all these years. My father died at 59, so he checked out pretty young.
Mm-hmm.
Probably because he wore himself out. He was such a rogue.
Mm.
I think I told you when we talked earlier that he was a school teacher and a plumber and an electrician and a sign painter and other things.
Other things? Like what? What other things could there possibly be?
Owned a dildo factory.
Yeah, oh, wow.
I said it. Oh, fuck you.
Oh, that's a great fucking story. It's so fucking good. Like all these things, and then, oh yeah, and the dildo factory.
Well, we were really careful who we brought over to the house. I'll tell you that. The minister didn't come over. It was all in the garage. Then he bought a building, or he rented a building. Dude. And it's another thing he did. He went into that same rubber stuff. He went into mobile home roof coating. Because the mobile homes, they have to have an expansive material on the roof. And when it gets hot, they expand.
Oh, okay.
The stuff will expand with the joints in the seams of the home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you little da da da. Mm-hmm. And so he came with this stuff called butylite. It was butyl rubber.
Okay.
Right? So he made all this, and he had a big mixer and did all this shit. He's like a madman in there. He had like a rag on his head. He looked like a lunatic. And then he sold lots of this stuff, like all over the United States. When it started raining, it turned white and ran off the sides of the mobile homes.
Oh boy.
So we got out of that shop like in the middle of the night, I think. And,
wow.
Yeah, so but there was nothing. And then he went that same business. He went into making his craft and did that for years, all mail order.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mail order dildos.
Yeah.
That's many moons ago.
You can probably get them on Amazon now.
I don't fucking know.
But I don't know.
Yeah. Interesting. Wow. I'm glad you put that part in there. You had all these super cool things and this other super cool thing. But so he had the mobile home roof coating first and then repurposed it into dildos.
He had this crazy German chemist that could make anything. And he said, look at this. I got this rubber and you can cut it, do whatever you want with it, and then put it in a crock pot and melt it back down. And he put some pigment in it and it was pink. My dad's perverted mind was off to the races. You know?
Wow.
Holy shit, Betty, you're telling my mom. Yeah. My mom would go, oh my God.
Wow.
Because she used to have to go to the post office with these tubes. And my mom was really straight.
Oh, man.
I don't know how she married my old man.
Oh, goodness gracious.
That was something.
Yeah.
What's your dad do? He's in manufacturing.
Yeah, he is. Mail order.
But he was mail order. And they used to advertise in these really cheesy men magazines. That was before.
Like Playboy and Hustler and shit like that?
No, not even that. Lower than that.
Dude. Dude magazine.
Dude. I think that was one. Adam. That was back when they didn't have the stuff that they have now. Mm-hmm. But I don't. Is everybody not my thing?
Yeah.
Not that I'm against it. It's not my thing.
Yeah.
And why they have to have it in like micro photography, I don't understand. Usually I thought it was the whole thought was the whole idea, but that's what I know. So that's where he advertised. And I mean, he sold thousands of these things. So these people that get them aren't alone. So there's nothing to be ashamed of.
Not at all. Not at all. Oh, you still got one?
No. I probably worth a lot of money.
I was saying,
I know
the bottom is
right. My dad made more realistic ones and
more realistic.
More realistic ones that were illegal. No, it couldn't look like the real thing at all.
Really?
That's from what I remember. So he had to be. There's a line you could walk with anything.
Wow. Couldn't be realistic. No veining, throbbing.
None of that. Ones. No, not the famous thing. You know, it's.
Generic pink.
I can't believe I'm talking about this shit.
Yeah, me neither. Look at you talking on the podcast. Oh,
right on. The stuff you talk about.
Yeah, man.
But that was him.
Yeah.
That was his reality.
Like an entrepreneur. Just like, I'm doing this. I'm doing this. I'm doing this.
No, he would just come home and say, I'm going to do some plumbing. He'd take an ad out and do plumbing. He knew how to do it.
He knew how to do plumbing, though.
Oh, he could do anything. Because my grandfather never hired anybody to do anything. My grandfather was from Holland and my grandma. Okay. Omi and Oma. Mm-hmm. He would never hire anybody to do anything at his house. So he could do anything. Woodwork, plumbing, electrical, painting. My dad I didn't follow that trend too much because I really don't like painting houses.
But you could fix an engine. You could do artistic iron. Yeah.
I can do some, everybody can do some plumbing. Every man can change a drain, you know. Well, maybe not every man.
I mean, YouTube is a wonderful thing.
Or woman. It's 2024. Girls.
No.
Can you say that, girls?
Absolutely.
Okay.
You can say whatever you want.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
Well, I'm not a bigot. I don't only think it's anybody, but I just don't understand, you know. I don't care.
Say what people you ask me
about my stance on religion. I say, I have nothing that's wonderful. I just don't care.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It just never crosses my mind. I've learned more from you.
From me?
From you. Some of the things you've read to me. That
I mean, you brought it up first.
I know. I brought it up first.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's interesting to me.
Yeah. Filling everybody in, Stephen was talking about how he had heard as a young man how back in the ancient days, farmers were required to round the edges of their fields. And then the corners were left for those less fortunate. For poor people.
And that's why the Hasidic Jews, that I was always told, the sideburns are called peyos.
Mm-hmm.
and that's what, then now they call them sideburns or something, but that was to signify from the Bible that they took care of the poor people by giving them the corners.
Exactly, yeah.
So it's very cool.
And I was, at that time, I was right in Leviticus on that fucking
and
pulled verse.
That page up and
showed me. I was like, click. I was like, you're right on it, man. Yeah. But super cool that, you know, it's written in a book, an ancient book that, hey, let's take care of everybody, you know? And service to others.
No, it is true. I never knew that. It didn't come from my uncle I spent a lot of time with, a Jewish guy. And he just told me snippets of things in life, but I didn't realize that he was taking them out of the Old Testament. Mm. You know, it was things that he learned, but he acted like he'd come up with the thing, you know?
Right on. Yeah, well, I learned this thing. Yeah. Right on.
So, yeah, that was
yeah, that was pretty cool. You know, it was one
it was
day
very cool.
We're talking it
was
about it. Boom, I read it. Things just happened right there in front of you.
That was pretty. It was good for me because I thought, Uncle Dave wasn't full of shit.
Beautiful.
Oh, he was good to me. Yeah, I learned a lot.
Good, man.
So other than that, what I was saying that, like, in my opinion, I've learned now that I'm older that sometimes it's not important in certain groups.
Your opinion is?
My opinion on something. Although sometimes I like to stir people's soup, especially if they're being an asshole.
Interesting.
It's good for me because I don't care. They cannot hurt me with words. You know, I'm freaking bulletproof.
Yeah, words are just words. Words have the meaning that you, or the effect that you give them.
Exactly. So I don't, you know, if somebody doesn't like me, okay.
That's cool.
There's only, 8 billion more?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Get in line, buddy.
Get in line. Yeah, the people that hate me, I don't think there's that many. A dozen, maybe. Imagine some North Vietnamese people hate me, but...
Yeesh. You know, that was many moons ago. Maybe they've given you grace and forgiveness since then.
Could be. Yeah. Know, what's really chill is a lot of them were Buddhist, you know?
Yeah.
And that just... That's what I was thinking. Like we had a situation where we killed some people, and so we always go through the stuff, you know, see if they have any weed. They always had weed, is part of the story. So part they had weed, and we opened this guy's wallet, and there was a picture of a couple of kids, and I'm thinking, wow, these guys just want to go out in the jungle, smoke a joint, and maybe think about their kids, and here we are. That old saying, there it is, originated in Vietnam. When you're trying to figure something out, people just said, there it is. And that was a pivotal moment for me that I thought, these guys are just like us. Man.
Interesting.
Yeah. And
families.
I mean, lives. I didn't stop doing my job, but I didn't volunteer I was a platoon sergeant. I didn't volunteer my guys for anything that was obviously really, really risky.
That's admirable of you.
Well, they would send us out on a night. They call them jacks, and those night things are stupid because you can't, you know, obviously.
Can't fucking see, yeah.
And this was, I wouldn't admit I did it, but some of the guys they'd send out, they'd say, are you there at a place they wanted you to go? We're here. Well, they weren't. They were only about 200 yards away from where the camp was.
Free GPS and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah, probably vision, cooking, you know, lasagna and shit. So so then they got hip to that, and they made us pop smoke.
Oh, wow.
To see, and the helicopter, the old man, they call him, some colonel, would fly over to see if we were really where we were supposed to be. And I thought, wow, they want to send us where it is.
Interesting.
Yeah, if they know there's NVA in a certain area, that's where they sent us. That's what I did in my long-range stuff. That's where they sent you. It was called a free fire zone. You burnt everything and killed anything. It's just... That's what they did.
Fucking A, dude.
Yeah, pretty trippy. And it's all these fat cats sitting in the back having their lobster every night. Oh, we'll move Alpha Company over here. We may lose, you know, 2%, but.
It's a strategy thing.
Yeah, I laugh now and I joke because it actually tickles something in me that,
somewhat expendable pieces. That is a valuable piece, no matter how you look at it. People are
they're the most valuable.
Yeah.
And I met the coolest guys. From all over, every color, and I can guarantee you that colored and all that doesn't mean, really means nothing when it comes to war and dying. Everybody bleeds the same. Yeah. Everybody dies the same. So we truly are. It is a brotherhood. I know that corny old brotherhood of man, but there's something to that.
Absolutely.
Because we're all here, you know, stroking, trying to get air.
Mm-hmm. Dig it, man.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Those are strange times.
Yeah. Many moons ago, too, right?
Yeah. I got out in 71.
71 and 69, you got drafted, yeah? In country most of the time, too, yeah?
Oh, yeah. The whole, I would have had 3 months to go when I came back. And they used to give you some stupid job in some Fort Dix or someplace, you mm-hmm. know?
That's New Jersey. Take it easy.
Well, that's your hometown. Yeah, that's exactly. Right. We always thought it was funny that it was Dix.
Yeah, know? It's fucking hilarious. McGuire Air Force Base is right down the road, too. All kinds of fucking...
Fort Dix. Yeah, and then, but they gave me a drop. I had to go to Orange Coast College in Southern California. It would take you without qualification if you were in Vietnam.
Mm.
Without, you know, you're just enrolled. So they signed the papers, and I got out 60 days early or something,
mm-hmm.
or 30 to whatever the hell it was. And I went to college like twice, and it was just right out of that jungle to college. And then I had a really interesting thing happen. I got from Vietnam. Mm-hmm. I got an apartment with number two.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, man, it sounds shallow.
No.
I'm really not that bad, guys.
Yeah.
You gotta maybe.
Got to keep him in line somehow. Yeah. Yeah.
I had an apartment, and the first wife, I had a son with her that I never saw because they were wicked people, but they were less than pleasurable. And I was in my apartment. I'd been out of the jungle about 5 days, and some guys knocked on my door, and they arrested me for non-support.
5 days out of the jungle.
When I was in Vietnam, evidently she went on welfare. She was married and divorced him, and so I was supposed to pay. I didn't know. Probably wouldn't have paid anyway because I'm in the jungle.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know how that works, but yeah.
But yeah, so they arrested me and took me in. I said, whoa.
Fuck a duck.
Yeah, welcome back to society. You know.
Wow.
I went to jail just for a night, but it's mm-hmm. enough for me. Yeah. It's not my place, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
Who's in jail are drunks and losers.
Happens, man. For non-support, and you're in an active fucking war zone 5 days earlier.
Yeah, active war zone, 5 days. Because in Vietnam, you went to the rear, and then I think I spent a few days there. I was the last 2 weeks, I did some colonel's aide. I think it was a colonel's aide. Mm-hmm. I never did shit for him. And then then they sent me to Fort Lewis and went home, and I still had open wounds from leeches.
Damn,
you know, so I knew I hadn't been home long.
Yeah.
And then they that was the Orange County district attorney sent these guys out and handcuffed me in front of my neighbors.
Fuck.
I wanted to kill them all.
Oh, yeah.
You know, 3 weeks before that, I could have and been blessed. But anyway.
Yeah. I mean, you beat that pretty handily, I'm assuming.
Oh, it was excellent. My, the judge actually threw it all out.
Yeah. I mean,
and
that had to fucking go nowhere.
Right.
Yeah. I didn't have to, but.
Actually, yeah. the first
judge... You got a great judge, fucking excuse.
The first judge made me go back into jail. I came on the bus and went to the court for this non-support's a felony.
Wow.
Anyway.
Hmm.
So that was when I got back from Vietnam.
Yeah.
And then I started working. I tried to get a job. It was unemployable.
How so?
Well, if they pissed me off, I was easily... Because I know it's a transition when you leave the combat area and you go back to being like regular people. It's kind of weird. It's very weird. And then when people all of a sudden you tell them, you got to do this, and you got that song went sign, let's say this, you got to do this, you can sign over there. Well, it was hard for me not to tell them to fuck off. Hmm. You know, you don't like my work? Well, you know, goodbye. And then I probably wasn't the wisest thing to do because I had a child.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just like my dad in a way. I had different jobs. You
know? Yeah.
And then we did the thing with him. We were off to the races.
Yeah. Unemployable. Hmm. Interesting. My pop had recounted tales of coming back from Vietnam and the transition being arduous. But that was one thing that he spoke to more than once. Is like, I don't like being told what. Yeah. he acclimated after many, many, many years.
Of course.
He probably still doesn't like being told what to do, but back then it was like...
Didn't he do two tours?
Did two. Yeah. Yeah.
I would like to talk to him and question his mentality.
So he came home after the first one, and he went to work in like a GM facility. I think his pop was working at the GM plant in Jersey. He went to work there for a week or two, and like you said, coming back and being in that college classroom and whatnot, he was like, send me back. And he signed back up.
Well, I know how he felt.
Yeah.
When I was in that classroom, I saw this kind of a preppy school.
Mm-hmm.
I think people still wore those saddle shoes and shit, mm-hmm. you know? Nothing wrong with saddle shoes, guys. I wouldn't wear them, but...
We'd have to look up saddle shoes.
anyway, they all had these opinions on war.
Mm.
And back then, the unit I was in were nicknamed the Baby Burners. Those Lieutenant Callie was in the same unit, if you remember the Callie Massacre, My Liar. Mm. So we got a lot of shit.
Mm-hmm.
And they were saying, you know, how could you have done that? I said, it's because they told me to.
Mm.
And in the 60s, you know, you did it, right? I mean, talk is cheap. When you get drafted, I mean, you're going.
Yeah.
I had friends that went to Canada,
mm-hmm.
and they didn't have great lives.
I'm sure.
They couldn't come back and get a job with anybody that would, they didn't used to vet people. You know? Like, you could be Jack the Ripper and get a job in a nursing home, you know.
Mm.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's crazy, but I know what your dad went through because mm-hmm. it was just hard for him. You guys don't know. You don't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
You're against the war. Well, good. Well, you know, don't get down on the guys that went. Yeah. That's what the deal. They were down on us. When I came home, I went to SeaTac, the airport. I guess I don't been there once.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Day, and when I was flying out, there were protesters. Oh, saddle shoes.
Had to find them.
Nice.
Oh, God.
There's protesters.
I had a pair of the brown ones, actually.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
So there were like active protesters when you came.
Oh,
back.
Active protesters! You know, like it's, I don't know what they were chanting. They always come up with some friggin' chant. They mm-hmm. think rhymes, but it doesn't. some guys got pissed off. I think you know.
Yeah, interesting.
Well, I ask guys now, my agent, how'd you get out of the draft? And a lot of guys didn't, you know, got out of it.
Hmm.
I don't know about your old man. Was he drafted or he joined?
No, he signed up.
He signed up. Yeah. So he had 3 years right off the bat.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was four, actually.
Well, he signed up for four,
right? Yeah. Yeah, he was right out of high school. You know, he came from a line of military. I mean, it was kind of like the classic thing to do back there. It's like, right. Oh, you can't really find work, do military stuff. You know, right. And his pop was in the military. And then, you know, when he was in high school.
Vietnam, it's a noble happened. Endeavor.
I would not disagree with that.
Right.
You know, some of the actions that. Some of the orders that are put upon you are not the noblest, last being of the warrior class.
What do you mean when they tell you we don't have room, we have no way to facilitate prisoners? They couldn't say what they really meant.
Yeah.
But we knew what they meant.
Yeah.
And I can see how they didn't. We can, you know, pal around with the guy until they got for a couple of months.
Yeah.
You're right. But your dad... Your dad had some moxie if he was out there beating that bush for 2 years.
He had something, man. I mean, again, he's, you know, early 20s. What else do you know? If that's all you've known is war and your really formative time and you're trying to come back and assimilate into a different society where protesters are telling you, you know, you're a certain way, not given the proper care or treatment that you may absolutely fucking need.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, hey, let me get the fuck out of here and go where I don't have that.
Well, your dad was 20. I was 20.
Mm-hmm.
And it almost seemed like an adventure. That's when I didn't mind quitting the program, Ranger program, to go to Vietnam.
Hmm.
I wanted to, you know, I was going to be here. I've been here 2 years, man. I've had all this training. Let's go do something.
Let's go use it, yeah. Interesting.
And then it was okay with me because they were considered bad people.
Hmm. The enemy.
The enemy, yeah. Well, we had two. I mostly fought my platoon, my whole division fought mostly NVA,
mm-hmm.
which are a little higher trained,
mm-hmm. The regular army.
Regular army, yeah.
Guerrilla group.
North Vietnamese Army, NVA. Yeah,
as opposed to the VC, the Viet Cong.
Right, the Viet Cong, or they called him Charlie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, that was the Charlies, they got you with booby traps and things like that. The NVA would get it on.
Yeah.
So that was my preferred way.
Interesting.
Yeah. And setting ambushes. Like I told you, we made mechanical ambushes out of claymores. And I'd just soon, you know, have a Gettysburg or something.
Really?
And get it over with.
As opposed to the guerrilla-style tactics.
Yeah, guerrilla styles. All we did was hump through the mountains. I was in the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
I was in a rice paddy twice.
Interesting.
The rest of the time.
Mm-hmm.
I was telling Audrey yesterday, but mm-hmm. we were talking about bear traps, and then there's rice paddy in the corners where you would go down into it.
Mm-hmm.
There was bear traps. I don't know where the hell the Vietnamese got bear traps, but they had them because the guy up, you know, the point man would go. Yeah. And then they put another one about 6 feet away because that would be the obvious place you would go around it. So that's the guerrilla warfare that's.
Hmm.
Anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it might have been a tiger trap or whatever they have as a.
Well, they do have tigers.
Yeah. Could have been a tiger trap.
Yeah. I don't know. In a rice paddy? I don't know. Maybe.
No.
Tigers they don't like to eat wet, do they? Well, I don't know.
Tigers swim.
Yeah, I think if they have to. Yeah, I don't know if they like it, but if they're having rice for dinner.
Yeah,
yeah.
Actually, you know, maybe they wanted because it was an Asian food. They probably like rice with their human.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Sure.
This fucking guy.
stuffed nice. Human.
Is there any Vietnam movies that you're like, that one's pretty fucking accurate?
Well, the one with Robert Duvall and the surfboard was a cartoon.
Apocalypse Now?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That was a joke. Full Metal Jacket was a little more right on. Especially a one poignant part in it where they were getting overrun and it was total chaos.
Mm-hmm.
Like it was nighttime. You have no idea where North is, you know, or where anything is. You're just, because it's so dark. And it was total chaos, and there's grenades going off and people yelling. And so that movie had a scene very similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they jazz it up a little.
Yeah, it's cinema.
Actually, most of the time it was monotonous. We played spades
right on.
With these little teeny decks of cards that the Red Cross would drop. A little teeny card, but everybody would keep his hand in his pocket. And then because you got 70, 60, 70 guys in a line. And you can't stay real close together because, you know, don't bunch, because then they'll get two with one shot.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's any Vietnam combat vets in here, they'll know that this. I'm not talking shit.
No, nobody thinks you are.
So we would play cards, and then 2-3 days go by for a week, 10 days, and then boom, 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 and we'd run into somebody. Well, they wanted us to. So all these helicopters flying over and airplanes were sending us to a spot. I spent some time with the Montagnards, the tribesmen in the mountains.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they're pretty trippy guys. They got big, big cheddies.
Huh.
I know their wives don't have tops on. And I know this guy next to me goes, don't look at their tits. Don't look at their
tits. How can I not look at their tits?
These guys'
tits
are right there. I've been out in the bush for 6 months. What do you mean, don't look at their tits? She looks pretty good to me.
Yeah,
yeah.
Wow.
Oh.
All over.
Yeah. We did the right into Laos and Cambodia
mm-hmm.
on some excursions. Not deep, but we weren't supposed to be there. Maybe you kind of run out of map, you know.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
A map. Interesting way to put it.
But I have a really good, I wrote that letter for my friend describing mm-hmm. one particular, the most horrendous day of all. He was my company commander. There was a couple. One guy got nerfed. But his name was John, and he was a cool dude. We're still friends. We don't talk much, but I helped him out with the VA. And I brought that all up again when I had to write the letter for him.
Yeah, and that's part of the story that I relayed on the podcast I dropped today. This gentleman, John, he was denied full benefits, was it?
Yes.
And then he asked you to write this letter of this extreme incident that happened to prove, like, hey, this really fucking happened. This is what I went through. Give me my full fucking
benefits. And everybody else got the benefits. that were in that, were, I mean, if they were in that scene at that day. Yeah, no. Anyway, so, right.
Interesting. And he ended up getting his full benefits, right?
I believe so.
Nice.
Because he had me, because I put some personal notes in there, like, you know, screw those bastards, you know, the VA, and they can't do this to you, but I'm sure, pretty sure it flew for him.
Good.
You know. Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah,
because it was a horrendous day. One of the craziest days I've ever had in my life. Friggin' insane. I mean, here you're like, you're like your pop. I was 20, maybe I was 21 by then. I'd been there for a while, but you had never seen shit like that. The helicopter crashing with all the guys in it, and they carried munitions, which they quit doing after that.
Yeah, took off.
They all went off.
Mm-hmm.
It was quite the scene. You can imagine.
I mean, I've not experienced it, but...
No, no, you never should.
Yeah.
You live through me.
Thank you.
It's way better.
Yeah, man. Yeah, man.
Yeah, so then Vietnam was the biggest thing in my life. That and I think love gotten and love lost and...
Beautiful.
Money gotten and money that gone and I've been up and down that ladder a few times.
Dig it, man.
Yeah. He's got, you know, so... Yeah, love lost is a big deal.
Better to have loved and lost to not...
And never have loved at all, right? No, there's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
Because every one of those women, I feel bad. I mean, I liked them all.
Yeah.
Or I loved them all.
Yeah.
You know, love's a relative term. I love, you know, your pizza.
Thank you. Yeah, man. Dig it.
Yeah, so I guess it is true. It's always better. Keeps us, you know, it gives you perspective.
Yeah.
If you don't have love in your life, or maybe not some monumental thing like veterans go through, but something that you can pull on to write how you are right now, like I'm okay now.
Yeah.
You know, everything's okay right now.
Mm-hmm.
It may not be in a year. Like I got a little sick.
Mm-hmm.
Well, very sick, actually.
Hey, you look good.
Yeah, thanks. Hey, actually, I do my best. Yeah. I could look sickly.
Yeah. Your snappy dresser.
Yeah, snappy dresser. I did do well. We lived in San Francisco. We dressed.
Yeah, you did. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Right on.
Those are good times.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Still good times. Many, many more ahead.
Oh, yeah.
You say you're sick. What do you got, the flu or something?
I have cancer.
Fucking cancer.
Cancer.
Fuck cancer.
The big C. I had prostate cancer.
Had, past tense?
Oh, I still do.
Okay.
No, mine.
You've been diagnosed with prostate cancer.
Yeah, with prostate cancer, and then they go this whole, like a boilerplate method. It's the first, you get a thing called a Gleason test, and they take a sample, and you get numbers, which always, you know, what the fuck you're talking
exactly,
about.
Exactly, yeah.
And then they decided to remove the prostate. When I was up here at, we call this Ventucky for medicine.
Right on.
If you're dying, you get the hell out of here. So I went to San Francisco, UCSF.
Yeah, perhaps the best.
And, yeah. Which, I don't know, in retrospect, maybe that wasn't that smart, because it would have been easier, because you got to go so often, and our house is an hour above the city.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you get in the city, you know, it can take an hour to get across the city.
Absolutely, yeah.
So I got that done. Then I came back up here about 5 years ago. I came back up here and got radiation. On that same pelvic bed, and then the hell did they do to me then? Then I got radiation, and they gave me these. They have a shitload of different drugs. They try apalutamide. We'll try that, and okay. We'll try enzalutamide and Lupron, a hormone thing. Mm-hmm. So the cancer never hurt. It was the friggin' treatment that you would. It was just the side effects are mind-boggling. My hat's off anybody with cancer. Holy shit, man. What a shit show that is.
Yeah.
Because you don't really ever know what's going on. Maybe somebody that's really knowledgeable about medicine, but I mean, I obviously looked at everything.
Mm-hmm.
But these medicines they gave me lasted about 6 months, and then they quit being effective. They measure your PSA, they take a blood test, and right. And they quit being effective. My PSA would climb. So I went to the next one, and my PSA would climb. And then they gave me, last year, I think it was, I got chemotherapy, which is quite a scene. It's the toughest thing on your body. Side effects are mind-boggling. I learned what the word neuropathy was.
Oh.
And that's a bad word. And then, so now I just recently got on some new one because my PSA started to climb after chemo, after 4 months, I think, or 5 months. And then I'm on the stuff called Pluvicto now, which is radium, nuclear medicine.
Nuclear medicine.
Yeah, so I go in and get a hoochie, a shot, and, and then 6 weeks later, you get another one, and you do that six times.
Hmm.
That's the Hail Mary.
Hail Mary.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, anyway, that's my sick part.
I mean.
Well, it's part of my life. It's a big part.
Yeah.
Because they've, you know, they, I can actually see a stop sign, you know, when you're, the rest of your life, it's all, it's over there, but it's hazy, right, to me. When he starts getting clear, as soon as it's time to run.
Interesting, yeah.
When you can see the letters.
That's an interesting
way to put it. Get the hell out of Dodge,
yeah, man.
Yeah, so this stuff, you know, evidently can put it in remission or give you at least a couple more years.
Yeah. Yeah, when you told me about it, I you know, did a little research on it.
I remember.
It's fucking banana science that goes into it. Like you said, nuclear medicine. They link this one with this one. So when they put it in you, it attacks only
the cancer
only cell. Cancer cells specifically. This shit is running through your body but knows to go there,
and it gets absorbed and then releases the radiation.
Fucking hey, dude.
And then the cell can't replicate. So it's I'm all over it, you know. Let the good times roll.
Yeah, baby. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things, you know, having seen you and been near you going through certain different treatments, I mean, your attitude's always been fucking
I really have a good view,
yeah,
of it. Agreed. Not like some people say, oh, well, you're gonna die of something. I don't buy that one. But it is what it is. To me, it's right back to Vietnam. There it is.
Yeah.
I can piss and moan and groan and cry, and I still got it. So let's make it as slick as possible.
Yeah.
You know, have good times, good friends,
And live with it.
Yeah, and live with it.
Yeah,
and
just live through it. You know,
you just go do groovy shit while you're waiting.
Yeah, yeah, we're here right now. You know, what's going to happen in the future? Tomorrow is not promised.
Right. Well,
Let's live right now.
I read this guy, philosophy. The guy's kind of like a Tao Te Ching guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then I read Eckhart Tolle, who put, you know, I can't stand his voice, but
he can't handle his voice.
And, you know, he had like Peter Lorre. Remember Peter Lorre, the actor?
Yeah.
But he had a good message.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can.
Right. Yeah, maybe reading Tolle would be better.
Right, yeah. No, I did read him first. But yeah, that kind of stuff helped me. Really getting into the Tao Te Ching, which can't be understood. I heard a guy said, you'll never understand it, but you can learn from it.
Yeah.
And it's
kind of like life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good book. It's a good read. It's a little heavy for me sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather read a cowboy book or something, you know?
Yeah, I could dig it.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Eckhart Tolle. Theo Vaughn, he's a comedian. You know Theo, right?
Yeah.
He just had Gabor Mate on his podcast. Did you watch it?
I have not seen that one yet, but I love
Gabor Mate. There's a clip. Mate. There's a short he pulled up about Gabor Mate. He's like, he's been through a bunch of shit. He's a high-level psychologist type kind of guy. But he talks about people end of life and their regrets, their number one regrets.
That's pretty interesting.
Theo's a comedian too, and he's fucking off the handle a lot. And he's like, you know, we had a fucking gorilla as a principal in, you know, Covington, Louisiana. It's like, fuck. But he's got these fucking banana stories. He's humorous, but he interviewed fucking Trump. He's a fucking comedian. He had Trump on his podcast, and it was a great interview. And at one point, they're talking about cocaine.
Yeah.
It was like, what the fuck? There's one clip on the, see if you can pull it up real quick. On YouTube, Theo Vaughn's channel, there was a clip, and it was Gabor Mate. Theo asked him a question, and he was talking about people's regrets at the end of their life.
No, I've seen snippets of that, and I'm not at that point yet, but I might have some.
There's some heavy hitter. Where shame comes from, don't wait. There you go. Check this out. That's Theo.
This is the comedian on the left?
Yeah, and that's Gabor.
Oh, he is.
Yeah.
Joey, you and I are in there.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
I mean that's the name of the fucking podcast.
I know. I mean, I'm glad I'm. That's not what's going on in my head.
Mm-hmm.
To be themselves, I'm just like you. I'm just a big leaky friggin' tank.
I mean, but having the courage and not being fearful to be able to be like, hey, this is me. If you don't like it, go fuck yourself.
Right.
You know, take it or leave it. I'm going to be my authentic self. Your circle is going to get fucking smaller. People are not going to like you for maybe things you say.
That's all right.
Fucking, that's all right, man. Can being okay with that. So you don't have to wear the weight of wearing a mask all day or putting this costume on to go be a fucking, hey, this is who I am. When right. you come home, it's like, oh, that's not who I am, but I had to play that character.
Right. Well, as politicians do that on a daily basis.
Hourly basis.
Hard
that fucking job.
Well, yeah. Yeah, no, it's, but if they, to me, even though, I mean, I'm, like we just talked about, I just say what's on my mind, but not in a mean way or not trying to be witty. It's just sometimes I get schooled by people. They'll say, oh, you don't know. That's not the way it is. And then they give me some stuff that, oh, wow, that's interesting.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. I mean, having the experience you do and still being open to that, that's refreshing to me, knowing that, hey, I'm going to be 80 years old at one time and still be open to learning and new experiences and perspective. From people being authentic, you know?
Well, the show's never over.
Yeah. Beautiful.
You know, my old man told me that it's not over until it's over, and you probably won't even know it.
Exactly. Then so it won't fucking matter.
Good. It's so over. Just let it roll.
Yeah. You wake up dead, and it's like, oh, I guess that's over. I don't have to worry about any of this shit anymore.
No, I like that, because I've read little things about people. They regret not, like, being closer with their children, mm-hmm. or they regret not being closer with their mom and dad, or... Mm-hmm. But not being yourself, being afraid to be yourself,
mm-hmm.
as a travesty.
Agreed.
Oh, you've been whacked hard. Mm. 'Cause you miss out on some cool shit.
Yeah, man. You can. Absolutely.
You miss out on the best.
Yes.
Wow.
Would you pull up, Charlie?
This is Epicurus. He's my favorite philosopher.
Your favorite?
Yeah.
You guys had drinks the other day?
No.
Oh.
But his quote, death is nothing to us since we... When we are, death has not come, and when death has come, we are not. So
exactly.
I fear.
Yeah.
Not here yet.
No, I mean, if that's going back to the Vietnam, that way I get a perspective on, we'll be in a firefight or something, and it slows down. It's pop, 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 pop. Nobody's hitting shit. And then two guys over, whack, the guy gets it. That's a sound you never forget when it hits home. And I thought, wow, you know what the first thing that would run through everybody's mind is? I'm glad it wasn't me. Isn't that trippy? I would think, oh my God, my comrade. But the first thing that would go through your mind is, thank God it wasn't me.
Damn.
Because I used to, when I got home, I used to have these kind of nightmares of the whack. You know, I'd go look out the window, and because I'm probably smoking reefer, but I'd look out the window, and then... I got really bizarre. I would like crawl up to the window and look over the edge because they were low windows to see who was out front. And then, because I would be picturing that the whack. So,
interesting.
Yeah, I just, it never happened to me, but it's interesting, the whole death thing,
mm-hmm.
that this guy didn't know he was going to get it. So he had no planning.
Hmm.
So it's important. I think what that other point was to get to is to do it now. Get rid of the charade. Be who you are. Run what you brung.
Yeah, man.
I love that term.
Run what you brung. That's a drag racing term.
That's a drag racing term. When you have a shitty car, everybody has cool ones. They say, run what you brung, man. But it's a good metaphor for things in life.
Absolutely.
Because you're Joey. You know, Joey, Schmoey. That's the way it is.
Yeah, man.
I like that.
Run what you brung. Yeah, man. I think I mentioned it. I wrote it on the wall up there, you know, listening or listening. What do you call that? Audiobooking on some old guy. I don't know. They were like, why do fucking warriors wear armor?
Oh, you're talking about that.
Yeah. Not Socrates.
No. So they don't get killed, I would think.
You're just prolonging death.
Yeah.
It's like,
what's the idea of life?
The warrior doesn't fucking want to die, but why wear armor? Why prolong it?
Was it Aurelius? Marcus Aurelius?
No, it wasn't Marcus Aurelius. It was, I fucking said it before.
You prolong it because it's so final. Hmm. There'll be no more philosophy after.
Perhaps, who knows? Yeah. Maybe that's where all the philosophy, all the fucking answers come to you and the fucking, it's like, oh, I fucking know all this shit.
Well, I wouldn't volunteer to find out.
There you go.
You know, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die.
Yeah, exactly, right? Yeah, right. Nobody's fucking lining up for it, right? Right.
Interesting. Well, I have people that told me, oh, man, I won't mind it. I'm ready. I'll be with my dog or his cat or something. I'm like, oh, okay. Hmm. Let's just run out in front of the bus and see if you meet your cat tonight. I don't know about that stuff. You know, it's just... I need more proof.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Alas, will there ever be proof? I mean,
I hope so.
At one point, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, will. Yeah. One way or the other.
One way or the other. We're all going to find the fuck out.
Yeah, man. It's the big question. Well, it's still interesting to analyze and think about. Don't just shut it off and mm-hmm. discount it.
Yeah, agreed.
I mean, because I went to high school. I mean, that was the end of my education. So, mm-hmm.
yeah, I mean, you've lived quite a life, though, that has, you know, you could have education without schooling, too.
Oh, there's no doubt.
And people have high-level fucking degrees that are different levels of intelligence.
That's kind of like in business. I mean, I had been doing it so long that I knew how it's going to come down, how it has to come down. We're having an argument on a job over something. I mean, I know how it's going to happen, so let's just cut the bullshit and get this. What is it? What do we need to do?
Yeah, cut the shit. Let's get to it.
Get to it.
I can dig it, man.
Well, cause the clock is ticking, you know.
Yeah. It is.
It's ticking.
Live your life, man.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing. I love that perspective. I mean, you have this huge body of work that you've done, and you're here now, you know, dealing with a terminal disease or whatever. And we're all dealing with a terminal disease. Life is a terminal disease.
Right. Mine's just a little expedited.
Perhaps, you know.
We'll see.
You get fucking, you know, a Hulk shot every fucking 6 weeks. And yeah. You know, you come out, you're like, wow, look at me now.
I do glow. I had a friend, I said, I always thought you had a glowing personality. Nice, dude. I ran, fuck you.
Man. Were those shades blasting out? Yeah. But yeah, it's great perspective. Still living your life, enjoying it.
As much as possible. Yeah. Just keep going.
Yeah.
Keep moving.
Suffer, heal, learn, push. You got to push through all that.
And you don't need, you don't need to accomplish any great things mm-hmm. as long as you're satisfied and you know you're straight, you know you're doing, you know, that you're not BSing yourself.
Exactly. Yeah, you could lie to yourself.
Self-bullshitting is pretty, that's, a lot of people do that.
And that's inauthentic from my perspective. Right. You know you're lying to yourself.
Right. You know?
It's a tough situation. You know, we talked about on the way to the car over here, just a little snippet. You know, last week had a cat who came in with a small group of friends and was being a bit of an asshole and whatnot. And we don't put up with that here. So he got not even a stern talking to. I was like calm to him and just being like, here it is. Take it or leave it. The fucking door is open. You can go or you can stay. Don't stand in the doorway. Ended up leaving, words, whatever. Thank you. Have a nice day. Comes back this week. Nothing. Clearly had an attitude change.
Right.
Ordered a sandwich, cup of coffee.
Left. Was he alone when you booted him?
No. Last week he had friends. And then this week, he was by himself. Not a small person either. This guy might have just came from the gym, was put together. And I was like, I'm glad that one didn't come to fucking blows. But
is he quick?
Oh, yeah, exactly, right?
Bulletproof?
Look at you, guy. But yeah, he had a totally different perspective, perhaps. It was a totally different interaction. I'll have this, blah, blah, blah. Here's the exchange. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoy it. Let me freshen up your coffee, blah, 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 blah. Know nothing about... Hey, remember how when last week, no sorry, not needed, unspoken, it was understood.
That'd be peachy with me.
Yeah, I'm fucking totally cool with that.
They call it burying the hatchet or whatever.
Absolutely.
Well, maybe his friend smoked him.
I would not say that is out of the question. It's happened more than once, too. I mean, there's been people in here that have tried to do me up and, had words and fucking kicked him out of the restaurant. I see him in there, 2 weeks later, it's like, I'm glad you came back. Thank you.
That's great. I'd much rather have that than some other guy that, you know, thinks I'm a dick and I think he's a dick. It's just so stupid.
Yeah, it's sucks up a lot of time.
Right.
Brain space. It can, if you let it. Or you could process it, let it fucking go. Have a nice day.
Well, yeah, you better let it go or you'll have so much hate. You won't have time to have fun.
Interesting.
My brother is like that. He's a he's not having fun. But now he's older than I am. I'm almost 78.
He's 109.
He's 109. Yeah. No, but he can be extremely unpleasant.
Interesting.
Just out of the blue, and as time went on in life, I just I'm not doing this, man. And the bro thing is out.
Mm.
If I'm not having fun with you. Or so.
Yeah, your circle can shrink when you stop putting up with some bullshit.
Right.
Interesting.
I read this. The guy that introduced me to Tao Te Ching, I can't remember his name, but his book is called Your Infinite Self.
Okay.
And it's really, really.
Google knows. We can pull it up.
It's really interesting guy. And he talks about dying.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that. His name escapes me. I've been sitting here trying to come up with it.
Okay.
Stuart Wilde.
Okay.
His amazing book that I highly recommend. He talks about the Tao. But then he also, I think he said that you really, it's hard. You can't ever figure it out. And mm-hmm. like we said earlier, but he talks about dying and he says, picture yourself in your life with like Joey and Audrey and we're all barbecue, whatever we're doing. Mm-hmm. And picture yourself, zoom out and look down at that scene.
Yeah, man.
And that's what it'll be. That's the only difference when you die is that you're just not, you zoom out of that scene. It's a little easier to buy the whole idea
mm-hmm.
of, I'm not real big on it, you know, like, okay,
you're not signing up for it, right?
It's not on my hit parade, mm-hmm. but, that's a great book. I recommend that too.
I'll check it out.
Spiritual Guide, Transcending Everyday Life and Tapping Your, in Eternal Nature.
Hmm. Eternal nature. So interesting fucking...
He gets into some trippy stuff. Like he sees like light if he gets into his transcendental state,
mm-hmm.
Which isn't... Ooga booga isn't really my thing, you know?
Ooga booga.
Ooga booga. Okay. Right, yeah, you know. Like,
oh, I do know, yeah.
No, I guess, no, it's good. I mean, if you like it, like it's like... he makes fun of the people that wear the saffron robes and their beads and that are teaching the Tao. And he said, it's so... It's you. It's not the guy in the robe with the beads. You don't need the beads. You don't need the robe. You don't need
a costume. Yeah.
You don't need an altar.
Mm-hmm.
You just need you and or God, whatever your deal is on God.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting. It was good for me.
Yeah. I mean, I like people that you know have certain perspectives that point out stuff.
I will send you a copy of that. That's what I will do.
Well, I mean, I could fucking probably.
Oh, Amazon, baby! I send books to everybody.
You get more fucking Amazon packages than I've ever seen. You guys were gone, and the Amazon packages were still coming. I'm like,
oh, I love those guys.
Put them
guys
on top of each other.
I love those guys.
Yeah, man. Beautiful.
Well, it's great. Actually, I had some guilt because luckily my business mm-hmm. and like your business, mm-hmm. they can't get it on Amazon.
Yeah, Amazon proof. Yeah.
Right, but if you have a candle shop downtown Vancouver, you're screwed
mm-hmm.
unless you're really like a charming person because they can get it on Amazon.
Yeah.
And have it here tomorrow. And I don't have to leave my house. And I got kind of guilty of that.
Mm.
And now what I've tried to do, when I see it on Amazon, I see who makes it.
Yes.
I had a special faucet for my desert home.
Mm-hmm.
I have an outdoor shower, which is my favorite thing in the world, yeah. Outdoor showers. No neighbors. I don't want to ruin all the women, you know?
Yeah, ruin them. Ruin them. Dude.
Okay, where was I? Oh, back to the
Amazon.
So I looked at this faucet in California. They have these stupid laws where they put a thing in the faucet where it cuts way down on how much water comes out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right, so they used to be able to gut them, and then they made it so you couldn't do that without breaking it. So I looked on Amazon at the guy that made it in Rocky Mountain, Foster Company. So he made me one.
Nice.
And went direct, and he got the money directly.
Yes.
And yeah. That's. And he told me that most everything on Amazon, the guy that sold it to you has never seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a...
It's a big fucking deal.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, most of those guys have never seen their product. They're merchandisers.
Yeah. Shopping local and...
Right.
You know, something you can get at a store that's, you know, a block away, or I could have it conveniently delivered. Bag of hammers, eagle's beak, two pizzas. And
yeah.
Shits it on your fucking doorstep 3 hours later. It's like, fucking beautiful.
Well, that's why I still go to Park Rose. And they're like Neiman Marcus of hardware stores.
Yeah, I got to ask for shit there. I was like, where are the screws?
Yeah.
Like, you have a whole fucking aisle of them over here. Thank you.
Yeah. Amen. Well, it's like the Home Depot. Yeah, it's hard to get somebody to wait on you with plumbing. Stuff, yeah. And a friend of mine told me he works there. Nobody wants to work plumbing because everybody that comes in doesn't know what he wants. So you got to be like a physicist to deal with.
I know all that shit. Yeah, man. I've gotten to the point where I go for something to repair something. This one's close. This one's close. This one's close. This one's close. Buying all four of them.
Right. You know?
One of them's going to fucking work.
Oh, I do that.
You know, I'm going to spend the $16 and not make 5 trips back.
Right, because I only needed $4 worth, but I didn't want to come back.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, don't you weigh? I'll weigh the logistics.
Yeah.
Over the bang for the buck.
Absolutely. The time of going back and forth. And
right.
Bananas.
Well, I'd like to interface with merchants. Like I went the Kinder. Is that the
Alex? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kindred. Yeah.
And it was wonderful because then I realized that she was the lady on your podcast.
Yeah.
And we chatted about business and. Mm-hmm. I gave my one little piece of advice is never become a slave to your overhead. And she goes, that's exactly right, huh? Never become a slave to your overhead.
That's beautiful.
Because people do.
Yeah.
You know, we had two new trucks out front and a motorhome and a boat. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking, Jesus Christ, what am I working for?
Yeah.
I'm supporting the goodie business, you know?
Interesting. Yeah. Yeah, Alex is getting ready to move soon. Her new space is getting done up. The old Harry's lock shop up on Main Street.
Oh, right close to me.
Nice. Yeah. She's moving up there. She's in there busting it out. Went in there and she asked me some questions about doing some stuff. And I think it just got painted. Yeah. She's getting... Alex is on it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she's going to do just fine up there, from my perspective. That's cool information
to get. She made a comment.
Mm-hmm.
About her name of her business.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like wanting it to cut. I could see Sherry Ann's reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you just sold glass shop, well, that she does so much more.
Yeah.
Right. It's like not even, that's a joke. Because mm-hmm. she does all the art and classes. And but then, what was it? I can't remember her name.
Alex. Alex.
Alec?
Alex.
Alice.
Alex.
Alex.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Like Alex Trebek.
Okay. I had a dog named mm-hmm. Alex. No offense. I mean, might offend her. Anyway.
She's good.
She said that, and you know how I am about, I'm a bit of a prepper.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I buy cases of canned goods, like you. It's just good, you know, it's good business. But she said that there's preppers that are kind of derogatory about using the name of homesteaders.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I say, so what? You can call themselves Elmer Fudskies, you know, it doesn't matter. But I wondered why that was, it almost like they thought it was not good
mm-hmm.
to be a prepper.
She talked about it. It was, it used to be Kindred Homestead Supply, and they pulled the homestead out because people were coming in looking for prepping type supplies.
Right.
And she was like, and then, you know, she went on and expounded on it. You can watch the episode. But, you know, she just shrunk it down. I went in there the other day getting a toothbrush, and she was like, "Yeah, I got 1,000 of these," and it was the old logo and name on it. I was like, "I don't think anybody's going to fucking worry about it on a toothbrush." But
right.
You can if you want; it's your business. So.
Well, I just thought it was. I didn't know. Then I was trying to figure out. Well, what did preppers? How did that affect her business?
She changed the name, so enough to change the name.
No, I'm wondering. Maybe I'm. You know, I never thought of a homesteader. I thought that was a guy that like built a cabin and. Had a tendril of smoke coming out of the stack while he's smoking his pipe.
She explained it a little bit too, and part of it had to do with the colonialism, right? With, you know, homesteading and whatnot.
There was the Homestead Act.
Getting land that wasn't theirs and shit like that. And she just wanted a distance from that, which is cool.
No, I get that. Yeah, mm-hmm. I just, being a prepper myself,
mm-hmm.
I thought maybe it was something that impacted somebody the wrong way.
Maybe her.
Maybe that's just personal.
Okay. Yeah, maybe she didn't want to associate with that or be aligned with that in some kind of way.
I didn't know. I wasn't. Yeah. I don't mind prepping. I think it's good to have food. And
agreed. What are you prepping for? You say you're a prepper. What are you prepping for?
Oh, I read all the apocalyptic books.
Oh, really?
Well, no, but some of them were actually very contemporary. Like all the, what's the name of that thing they drop and takes all the electrical out? You told me the name.
EMP.
EMP.
Electromagnetic pulse. EMP. Hmm? I thought it was emergency medical transport.
EMT.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, EMP. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyway, so one of the ones I read that they did that and shut down the power plants mm-hmm. and everything went to hell in a handbasket because nobody had electricity.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then you watch through the whole book. I mean, some of it's a little fantastic, but it's not real the utopian, you know, weird zombie kind of shit. This guy was like quoting the how long it takes for the grocery stores to run out of food. It's like 3 days because mm-hmm. they're bringing food into Freddy's 24 hours a day, mm-hmm. right? There's big trucks. You don't see them, but they're mm-hmm. in the back. But yep. So that's they run out in 3 days. So it doesn't hurt to have 30 days worth of food.
Agreed.
That's just my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah. And certain other things, maybe water.
Of course, water.
Hygiene supplies.
Remember toilet paper during the right? COVID, my
yeah.
God.
Yeah, man. Install your bidet now.
Right.
Or I guess if it's not electrical, it's not going to work if the power's out.
No, you'd have
your
to
hand
have,
pump.
You'd have to have a generator for yeah, your exactly. bidet. You
know? Honey, hook the bidet up to the generator. Power washing for sure.
Oh, I was in my desert house. I bought this Japanese toilet that.
They're the fancy ones.
Oh, no. You walk in the room and the lid lifts.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Oh, it's so great. It closes, cleans itself. It
just, yeah, man.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
It would be such a loss of luxury yeah. if there was an
EMP. I don't know why I did that because it was really pricey, but I really had to have it.
I mean, I've heard lots of stories about them and whatnot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it was my house. So if it comes to my. They can have the other homes. I just want that one.
Yeah.
If I can get you out there, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, we'll check it out. Yeah, prepping comes in many different levels, too. Some people think, you know, water, food, some kind of basic medical stuff. If you don't know how to use any of that shit, good fucking luck. Some people say if you don't have means of defending it, you're just stocking it up for somebody else, too. You know? But it's good to fucking know your neighbors, perhaps. You know? You know, I got this, you got that, we could swap.
Well, that's
please don't kill me for
that's
it.
That's what worked in the book, the last book I finished. That
that's
they,
what worked?
They, yeah. Well, the only way they survive was as a family. You know, like... mm-hmm. neighbors that took yeah. care of each other community. And they watched the roads and so it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, knowing your community and you know, community is a topic that's come up many times on here, but in times of disaster or emergency, whatever you want to call it, you know, watch that community come together.
FEMA's damn near useless.
Seriously.
I mean, they probably do some good things.
Yeah, I wouldn't know. I mean, I've only heard stories. What's happening in
North Carolina.
Oh, they each got Florida. $750. They're rolling.
I don't think they fucking get, like, people weren't being approved for it and shit like that.
No, while they're busy making decisions, people are dying.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, there's towns that still don't have, like, wireless access or any kind of internet, so we just don't know. I mean, we've seen the planes fly over in North Carolina and stuff like that. Just towns just wiped out, just flooded completely.
Well, they're... It's like in Mexico, there was $100 million from the government put on the street to put into welfare programs. Only about $500,000 of them make the street.
Oh, yeah.
So it's kind of FEMA's kind of a more legal version of that. And if you don't have power, it isn't 2024 in the U.S., man. There are people driving $300,000 Lamborghinis.
Mm-hmm.
This guy in Louisiana can't do anything.
Yeah.
Can't flush his toilet.
Yep. Yeah, there was one of those controversial conservative type people. Charlie Kirk, is that a guy?
Oh yeah, yeah. I can.
Is he a younger guy?
Yeah, a little bit older than
me. He was on a college campus, maybe. And this young lady came up and was like, "Hey, my mom is in Asheville, North Carolina, whatever, but she doesn't have a house. Blah blah blah. She's not being there's many people are not being approved for the $750." And she was like, yeah, that's the fucking guy.
He's a strange looking dude.
Oh, why'd you do it with his face?
Oh, I like that.
That's hilarious, dude.
Yeah.
Steven, this was great, man. Thanks.
Thank you.
You know, all our backyard and front porch conversations, doing it here for other people to get a sneak peek into you.
Ooh.
Great, man.
There's some people going to get a real sneak peek.
Fast forward to the dildo conversation. Nice, man.
Oh, here it is what it is.
Yeah.
Like, nobody can do anything to me. I'm bulletproof. Like, you know, nobody can come after me. Yeah, I don't owe any money. I'm basically a nice guy.
I agree. So
fuck them. What you see? What you see?